Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Before we go to Mr. Connolly, just because most people in the audience, including on the dais, don't understand Chief of Mission authority, would you, as Chief of Mission, run us through who was under your Chief of Mission authority and who wasn't? In other words, who did you have command and control of? And we're talking about military assets, because I think a lot of folks up here are hearing two chains of command, and it would be helpful for you to explain it as a career State Department person quickly.
All civilian personnel in civilian USG personnel in Libya were under Chief of Mission authority, which was yours. Until we knew that he was dead, and then that passed to me. The four members of the Special Forces team were under General Hamm's authority. We had two other military Special Forces personnel in country, and I was at that time unclear as to whether they were under my authority or not.
So anyone you had under your authority, you gave orders to, they responded, they went downrange if you asked them to. The others were not allowed to.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Mr. Connolly, thank you very much. You'll have your full time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for that clarification. By the way, there have been some statements that Undersecretary Kennedy was not interviewed by the ARB by Ambassador Pickering and Admiral Mullen. That is a misstatement fact. He most certainly was. You can look it up. It's documented. He was interviewed, and he provided evidence, and that evidence was evaluated. So it is simply not true that the Undersecretary Kennedy was not part of that process. He most certainly was. And I'd ask, Mr. Chairman, the record so reflect.
Who said he wasn't? I'm not sure.
I think we've heard it from the table. Mr. Thompson, statements have been attributed to you that your bureau, the Counterterrorism Bureau, was actually deliberately kept out of post-Benghazi developments, decision-making, and so forth. Are those statements attributed to you accurate?
It's true that my portion of this office was not participating.
Your portion. To whom did you report?
I report to Dan Benjamin at the time.
And did Mr. Benjamin, was he included?
He was overseas at the time.
He was overseas, but was he kept informed and involved?
I kept him informed in the early stages of...
Was he kept informed and involved by the Secretary's office?
I have no idea.
Would it surprise you to learn that he has stated emphatically that he most certainly was?
It wouldn't be a surprise. I've read it.
And would it surprise you that he contradicts your statements or statements attributed to, and I read to you, this charge that we were kept out of the loop in the aftermath is simply untrue. Though I was out of the country on official travel at the time of the attack, I was in frequent contact with the department. At no time did I feel the Bureau was in any way being left out of deliberations that it should have been part of, unquote.
I would disagree. He's true factually. He is his view of how much of
okay.
the CT Bureau was.
So for the record,
if I may, sir, if he thinks he was adequately informed and given counsel on that, then that is his professional.
Well, he's the head of the Bureau, and he's in fact was your supervisor, and that's his testimony. So it contradicts your.
I don't think it's his testimony, sir.
Well, I'm entering it into the record, so it's now in the evidentiary record. And
would the gentleman suspect?
We could. No, not. I will, Mr. Chairman.
I'll hold the time.
Okay, certainly.
Mr. Cummings, perhaps you were here, perhaps not, has said among a lot of people that we want to bring before this committee, he is now an anticipated future witness, so he can give testimony.
The chairman anticipated exactly the point I was going to make, so we can clear that up by having Mr. Benjamin here. Thank you. Mr. Hicks, I don't think anyone who could have listened to your account, the minute-by-minute account of what happened, could be anything but moved. The trauma of what you and your colleagues must have gone through, especially being in Tripoli, not being able physically to sort of reach out and do something about Benghazi, I think all of us can relate to that. It's terrible. I was in Libya and Tripoli in May of last year before the tragedy, and I don't remember whether we had a chance to meet or not, but David Dreyer led our CODEL. We were not allowed to stay in Libya overnight. What struck me when I arrived in Tripoli was that the airport security was provided by a militia. And, you know, I've traveled a lot over my years in foreign policy, and what goes through the mind is what could go wrong with this. It's a volatile, violent, unstable, or was situation. Do you want to talk just a little bit about the domestic situation in Libya as we found it? Because I think sometimes that gets forgotten in the retelling, that we're facing instability in Libya still in a post-Gaddafi revolutionary situation, and likewise in Benghazi. Could you just share with us some insights into what you found in terms of that inherent instability?
Thank you, Mr. Connolly, and thank you for being my representative. First of all, I just want to say that I don't recall saying that anyone other than myself testified to the ARB or was a witness before the ARB. So I wanted to say, be clear about that. The second thing is the political and security climate in Libya at the time. It was highly unstable, although after the elections, we thought that the political trajectory, the elections in July, we thought the political trajectory was heading in the right direction. President Magariaf had been selected. They were trying to appoint a new prime minister and move towards a democratic government. The security scene, however, was very unstable and has been, I think, well documented. You had assassinations and car bombings in Benghazi, but the assessment was that this was Libyan on Libyan and not necessarily directed at foreigners. At the same time that we are in the process of building towards making our post in Benghazi a permanent post, the British are contemplating returning there to Benghazi. They left after their ambassador survived an assassination attempt in June. In Tripoli, we also have instability. We have car bombings, carjackings. We have Islamic extremist militias that begin to attack Sufi shrines, and a government that is struggling to maintain security and improve security in the country.
Thank you, and Mr. Chairman, if I could just say to my constituent, we're proud of you, and I would add my voice to that of Mr. Cummings. I'm a member of not only this committee, but the House Foreign Affairs Committee, and you have my personal pledge that were there ever to be any hint at retaliation or retribution for your willingness to come forth and tell your version of what happened, this member of Congress will intervene on your behalf forcefully.
I thank the gentleman. The gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Duncan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And first of all, thank you for calling this hearing. There's obviously great interest in and concern about what happened in this tragic incident. Mr. Nordstrom, we've already heard Mr. Thompson say that he was never interviewed, even though he requested to be interviewed. Did I understand you correctly to say a few minutes ago that you know of other witnesses that had firsthand knowledge who were not interviewed by the board?
No, I don't believe I.
I guess I misunderstood about that, but I will tell you though, I was a criminal court judge for 7.5 years trying felony criminal cases, and I can tell you that it's surprising that anybody with firsthand knowledge wouldn't be interviewed about this unless somebody did not want to have a complete report. Mr. Thompson, what were you told was the reason you were not interviewed?
I was not given a reason, sir.
You were not given a reason. Mr. Hicks, do you feel that the report lets any individual or bureaucracy off the hook?
Yes, sir. I think that in our system of government, the decision-making authority is at the level of presidentially appointed, Senate-confirmed individuals. That's at the level of assistant secretary or higher. Now, the reporting coming out of Embassy Tripoli on conditions there, particularly the fact that we had to provide a daily report of who was in country to Undersecretary Kennedy, and the fact that he made the decision as to who came to Tripoli and Benghazi or who didn't, that budgets came to his table, and that security threat environment reports also came to his table would suggest that there is some responsibility there.
Mr. Thompson, let me ask you this. Another thing I find surprising is that do the security people not consider the date of 9/11 to be, we've already heard somebody say that this mission was considered to be a high threat or a high risk mission. Do they not realize that 9/11 is a high security type date and they should be prepared for terrorist activities on that date in particular?
Certainly. When I hear security, I think of Greg Nordstrom, so I won't go down the security trail too far here, but certainly on the anniversary of 9/11, since 9/11-2001, we have all had our antenna up, so to speak, and been forward-leaning, if not physically, mentally, on that particular day, yes.
The report basically puts primary blame for this situation on the Bureau of Diplomatic Security. I would like to ask if any of you have a comment about that. Do you think that's fair?
If I could,
yes, Mr.
Norton. Maybe this might also address Congressman Connolly's question. But my concern with the report is not that Undersecretary Kennedy was or was not interviewed. I don't know who was interviewed. Again, that's part of the confidentiality of it. But there's been a lot of discussion of how many people were supposed to be there or not supposed to be there. Those things are not driven by regulations and law. That's a subjective opinion. Obviously, that was quite a bit of my testimony in October. I go back to who authorized embassy employees, U.S. government employees, to go into facilities that did not meet legal requirements. I don't know who made that decision. And the reason why is because, as Ambassador Pickering said, he has decided to fix responsibility on the assistant secretary level and below. How I see that is, that's fine, it's an accountability of mid-level officer review board. And the message to my colleagues is that if you're above a certain level, no matter what your decision is, no one's going to question it. And that's my concern with the ARB.
Mr. Hicks, did you find other shortcomings in the report?
Well, I find shortcomings in the process.
In the process.
Although I was interviewed for 2 hours, I was never allowed to review the recording of my testimony to the board. I was never given an opportunity to read the unclassified report before it was published to see if my testimony had been incorporated or properly, at all or properly. And I have never been given an opportunity to read the classified report.
All right. Thank you very much.
I thank you. I must admit, one of the rules of this committee is that interviews and depositions, the witness actually gets a copy of and is allowed to make corrections in most cases to make sure that they didn't misstate something. So that is a little surprising to me. The gentlelady from California, Ms. Spear.
Mr. Chairman, it's ironic that you said that, Mr. Chairman, since Mr. Thompson would not even engage with the Democratic side of the aisle in terms of answering any series of questions. But let me first of all say to the family members, we lost extraordinary servants to this country. You lost loved ones. And there's nothing that we can say that will ever heal your huge loss. But know that we will do everything in our power to make sure that other families do not go through what you're going through. To you, Mr. Hicks, thank you for your extraordinary service. You know, as you were retelling the events, and they were harrowing, it reminded me of an experience that I had, similar, in a foreign country, ambushed, and a sense that we were woefully underprotected. And And I think as part of what we're going to glean from this today is that